practice mode.
I went for
oh,
it.
Oh no.
Awesome.
Oh no.
Hey, good evening, morning, afternoon, wherever you are. Thanks so much for joining us. Just letting everyone take their virtual seats and we will get started shortly. You know I'm gonna ask this as we're getting settled in. Please pop in the chat. Where are you logging in from tonight? Chicago, Vanoa, good to see you again. Thanks for coming. Diego, we've got SoCal, Philippines. Oh my goodness. Agesh, thanks for joining for night two.
We got some East Coast folks joining us today.
Go ahead and get started here. So it goes without saying, first and foremost, welcome everyone, and thank you so much for joining us in tonight's event on Break into UX Research, Ask the Experts. Before we delve into the main panel, we've just got a few announcements. So first of all, I'm James, president of SDXD, and we're a community of 3,800 UX professionals who gather regularly for inspiration, connection, and education. I'd like to thank my fellow organizers, as well as our volunteers, and do a quick plug for our upcoming event. So you may or may not know that the average individual unlocks their smartphone in excess of 80 times a day, and just 5 minutes of distraction can require 23 minutes to regain that original focus. So next Monday, we're hosting an event called Working on Your Relationship with Work from Home, How to Stay Focused, Productive, and Sane. So if you're interested, please visit our meetup page. And did somebody say holiday party? That's right. On December 10th, we're joining forces with the Denver UX Newbies, Denver UX, Boulder UX, and UX Speakeasy for an epic virtual holiday party experience. I'm not at liberty to say too much, but I've heard there's going to be cooking and mixology classes, perhaps some bingo, as well as musical and magical performers. That said, we want to hear about your ideas and the talents you might have that you'd like to share with the community. So if you'd like to be a part of the party, please visit that bit.ly link below. And now I'll hand it off to Lene of Denver UX Newbies.
Thanks, James. Hi, everyone. I'm happy to announce that we are here tonight with SDXD again and giving you this wonderful event. So you can go to the next slide. And here's my other organizers, Chelsea and Ryan. They're here tonight as well. And we're happy to keep bringing new events to UX newbies and other people in Denver. So our next event is coming up on November 10th. It'll be an uplifting event about some newbies in the field who recently got hired. We're gonna hear all about how they did that, some success stories, what went right, what went wrong, and just get some good tips on how we can also get jobs. So next up, we have Tiled is here tonight. They provided this wonderful webinar for Zoom. And Betty Lau is here to talk about a little bit more about Tiled. She's a product designer for them and also on the SDXD board.
Thanks, Lene. So Tiled, where I work at, is a micro app platform that really enables creatives to build micro apps. And micro apps are very lightweight app-like experiences without the heavy lift of development. And with Tiled, we want to empower creatives to really communicate their best ideas using rich and interactive content. I'll let the video speak for itself. Thanks.
Thank you so much to Lene and the Denver UX newbies, as well as Betty and Tiled for their continued partnership. And I'd be remiss if I did not mention the amazing UX Coffee Hours. It's an incredible mentorship platform where you can connect with over 100 mentors from all disciplines of UX. Research, of course, design, also writing and program management, no strings attached. So huge thanks to Tejas and the entire cohort at UX Coffee Hours. Just a quick overview of tonight's agenda. We'll have a 40-minute moderated panel followed by an audience Q&A. And then we'll actually hop into a regular Zoom meeting, not a webinar, for some optional breakout room networking. Just a friendly reminder, please don't be shy. The chat is there for a reason. We don't mind if you talk during the event. And if you have any questions, it would make our lives easier if you pop them into the Q&A modal of Zoom as opposed to the regular chat. Now, I'd like to hand it off to our incredible moderator, Brittany Schiesel. She's UX Research Director at Blink and is passionate about people and technology. Her goal is to improve people's lives by delivering insights that create human-centered products, services, and experiences. Brittany has been in UX research for the past decade. And outside of work, you might see Brittany helping out as a board member at SDXD, going on a run at the beach, hanging out with her two pups, or spending quality time with her wife and daughters. Now, I'll hand it off to the amazing Brittany to be tonight's moderator.
Thanks so much, James. Really excited to be here tonight and to learn from our UX research experts, Megan, Zoe, and Samyukta. So I'd like to give a brief introduction to each one of these wonderful ladies. The first one is Megan Kierstead. Megan is a researcher and educator with over a decade of experience in helping companies of all shapes and sizes build products that solve real problems for real people. She has a BS from Wellesley College and an MS from UMass Amherst with a strong focus in social science and anthropological research methods. Megan's passion is really to help create a new generation of compassionate, emotionally healthy leaders in tech. To that end, she now runs a successful coaching business that helps people in UX overcome their imposter syndrome to become incredible leaders and build fulfilling lives. She lives in the Bay Area with her three bunnies, Gina, Butch, and River, and is typically either covered in flour or glitter. Welcome, Megan. Next, we have Zoe Glass, and Zoe currently leads research for Lyft's new rentals product. She started her UX career at YouTube. She received her BS from the University of Montana and MS from Purdue University. Zoe has long been an ardent researcher of human behavior and made the zag into UX in the past 4 years. Previously, she focused on conservation behavior, studying things like how religion and living areas affect willingness to conserve wildlife. In her spare time, Zoe enjoys mentoring others looking to make the jump into UX and competitive cycling, as well as hiking with her corgi, Fletcher. Thanks for being here, Zoe. And last but not least, I'd like to introduce Samyukta Sharugar. Samyukta is currently a researcher at Facebook, understanding how to balance the needs of advertisers and end users. Previously, she was at Google, uncovering the unmet needs of app publishers. 5 years ago, she made a switch to UX research from a development background. She has a master's in human-computer interaction from Georgia Tech and an undergraduate degree in information technology from India. When she is not anxiously planning the next research study, she spends time mentoring early stage UX researchers, dancing, and watching more movies than she could probably should. Thanks for joining us, you guys. So for the next 40 minutes or so, we'll be doing a moderated discussion of topics that we've pre-selected. And after that, we'll be opening up to Q&A. So as James said, please feel free to drop in your questions along the way as we're talking. I wanted to open it up actually by just getting a brief overview of your career journey. So Meg, did you want to start us off with describing how you got into UX research?
Absolutely. Like most people, or at least people who've been around for a while, I didn't know UX existed in college. So for me, it was definitely a bit of an accidental journey. I majored in political science and computer science in undergrad. My interest was always in the intersection of people and technology, but I didn't know how to do that exactly. So I considered going to grad school right away, but I ended up actually at a tech company, being a business analyst, business consultant, product manager. Over time, I got more and more interested in HCI, human factors, and then I learned that UX was a thing. Especially, I was on the East Coast, so it definitely hadn't hit out there, you know, 10 years ago. Then I went back to grad school because I really wanted to bone up my methodological background, and founded a consultancy, worked with a bunch of startups, worked at Salesforce, and now here I am, many, many years later. That's a highly abridged version of my journey.
Thanks. Zoe, did you want to share a little bit about how you got into UXR?
There was supposed to be a space bar trick that didn't work any longer. So I definitely zagged into it as I introduced myself with. I started in wildlife sciences, and actually very specifically, like, how can we train skunks to run on treadmills to look at exercise efficiency? How can we use elk poop to discover what their migration patterns are? So very much in those like hard sciences of wildlife, which was amazing. But I think I very quickly realized that there was not a lot of impact you could have on conserving animals by actually just focusing on the animals, because at the end of the day, it's about humans. So I ended up going to get my master's in that field. Again, loved it. The downside being it's mainly in government. And full respect to the people that are really patient and can work in government. We need you, please do it. I'm not one of those people, I am not patient. So actually in one of, to Meg's point, I didn't know UX existed, and I was kind of in this, I don't really know what I wanna do next type field. And a friend of mine was sitting in a meeting and overheard that somebody was looking for a researcher and threw my name in the hat, and kind of made this unexpected jump into UX at YouTube. Had an amazing 2 years with the company and decided to go back a little bit to my conservation roots and took a job at Lyft. On the idea that if I'm doing my job really well, fewer people are owning cars, and that is a conservation mission. So big fan there, and that's how I got here.
Super interesting, especially the skunks running on treadmills. Sam, what about you?
I think the sort of common theme here is, I guess all of us like sort of did not realize UX was a field as we were, you know, through our early education. And that's definitely something that rings true to me. And I think at this point, like my lifetime spent writing code is still greater than my lifetime, you know, doing research. And I'm like working towards increasing the balance there. But yeah, I started all of my education growing up has lent towards computer science. And I guess I loved it for a time, but I got into the industry and started, you know, working as a software engineer and just did not get, you know, fulfillment from it. I started working at Oracle in India, and, you know, the projects that I was put on, I ended up being a front-end engineer. And, you know, the interesting thing there was I started working with people who were in UX. And there were, like, you know, good people who while doing work also were like, you know, I would spend time with them, sort of see how they were approaching the projects that they were working on, and realize that that's what really called out to me. So that's when I started doing my research into, like, how can I not leave all of my tech background behind, but also, like, sort of do a job that I'm more excited about. A roommate of mine at that time, a friend of mine had a roommate, and she was studying in University of Michigan at the time, who was studying to be a UX designer at UMich School of Information. And I was just like, you know, I spoke to her, and I think you have to, it's kind of like meeting the right people who give you the right inputs. She was just so inspiring and really welcoming about, yeah, you should totally, like, check this out. And, you know, didn't make me feel like an outsider at all. And I think that's kind of something that inspired me to look into a little bit more of what the field exactly was. And and then I went on to get my master's in HCI, a bunch of research, internships, projects, and here I am now.
Great, thanks for sharing that. So as you guys have alluded to, the common thing is, yeah, that this is still an emerging field. So the next question I'm gonna ask, I'm sure we've all encountered before, and I'd love to hear your answer to this. What's your elevator pitch? Someone comes up to you and says, what do you do? What do you say?
I'll fall on the sword. I try to do the one sentence version, which is like, I help other people understand people to build better stuff. That is like as kindergarten as I can go.
I think that's a great one, Megan. I wish I had a great thing for this, because I swear to you all, I have explained to my stepmother what I do every single time we've gotten together for the past 3 years, and she still has no clue. I think the easiest way to do it is actually to take something that is broken, something that you know is not working, and kind of say, hey, together we can agree, like, this isn't right, but this huge company put it into the world. So what could we do to actually figure out what's working or what's not working? Or more specifically, like, my step-parent is over 75, so things work really differently from her, and her frustration often comes out. So it's really showing her how the empathy we have in technology is actually now a position, right? Like, someone is looking at these questions for her to make sure things work for her. So really coming at that empathetic angle, which is such the researcher answer. So more show, not tell type thing.
Yeah, I think, you know, you both covered it really well and rather elegantly. So I'll maybe this is a little funny, but what I end up doing is to have to tell people two things, which, you know, if you're looking for a career in UXR, just brace up, you'll have to do this, is I am not a UX designer. I have friends who, for the, like, they've known me so long, they know what I do. And, you know, still at parties and gatherings, they're like, oh, Sam, you're a designer, right? You should be able to, like, give an opinion. I'm like, nope, I'm not. I'm closer to any other researcher that you can pick. And I guess the other easy way to explain to people who aren't from a tech background and who aren't in UX or who haven't heard of UX, I try to sort of draw parallels to market research. I know it's not the same thing, but I found that to be the quickest way to get people to understand what it is that I do at a high level, at least, and then I take it from there. So yeah, my elevator pitches have not worked, so maybe I should borrow from Zoe and Meg.
Yeah, I think we've all probably had some successes and fails in how we describe what we do. So, the next question that I have is really, I mean, what do you wish that you knew from the beginning? We gain a lot of knowledge along the way, but at the beginning, if your current self could give advice to your previous self, what would that look like?
Yeah, so I've got a couple cliches for this and then a couple that are a little more deep. And the first one is just say no. I think it's really tempting to just continuously respond to research requests. And it feels like, oh, they're respecting research because they're asking for it. And the thing is, research can be really politicized. Like, they can very often ask for research very specifically to get at an outcome that you know isn't right, or interpret your research in a way that isn't right. And it's really standing up and saying, I am the defender of the user. At the end of the day, the person that stands between me and Facebook making every other Instagram thing an ad is me, right? And so that's my responsibility. And I have to really take that into account and be willing to fight at those meetings. And I think in that, that whenever I'm fighting for something in the meeting, like, remember, those people are behind you. Like, you really are their voice of hundreds of thousands of users, potentially billions of users. So taking that responsibility seriously, which also means saying, no, I'm not gonna do that research, or no, that's not the correct interpretation. So cliche, but please lean into it, say no a lot. And the other is also, like, early career growth in research is difficult. You have to prove impact. And that's very different than that I can do a great job. You could be the most amazing detail-oriented researcher in the world, but if you are not changing things within the product, making it better for the user, making it perform better, you're actually not doing a very good job in the eyes of tech. So when you're thinking about prioritizing your own roadmap, your own work, and representing it, think about, like, well, what if this is actually gonna help me shine? You gotta be a little bit selfish. And I think especially as empathetic, predominant people, it's really hard to do, but be selfish, lean into that, make sure it's gonna be helpful for you down the line as well.
Yeah, plus one to both of those, especially the no, saying no bit. I think, like, for me personally, I'm a bit of a people pleaser, and I totally, like, you know, would go on for the ride of the product team where it's like, yes, research is politicized, and, you know, you sometimes are just doing research to back someone else's strategy. And what I found interesting is, like, you actually don't gain respect from anyone when you do that. Like, it's sort of like contradictory in the sense that the thing that you think doing will please people will actually, like, sort of undermine your authority and your sort of expertise. So the more you say no, the more you stick to your guts and sort of follow the process as it's meant to be followed, people will come to you because they know that you're the researcher who speaks the truth, your opinion matters, and you bring value to the table. So saying no really builds that. And I think another thing that I've sort of really learned is also, like, that research is a team sport. I think early on I would totally try to do everything on my own and get so anxious. You know, you can't, you're aiming for 8 participants, no one signed up, you know, that's like my problem to solve. Participants are sort of really struggling through the prototype. Have I designed the study wrong? It could be a number of different things, and, you know, you tend to take things on yourself, but, like, research really is a team sport. Yes, there are of course things that you have to do in terms of, like, being organized and getting things right, but, like, open up, like, all of the open up the mystery box that is the process of you doing research, and communicate at every step of the way. If you can't find, like, you know, 8 people who meet the recruitment criteria, like, maybe that's sort of a sign to the product team that, like, you know, this we don't have the right criteria here, or maybe we're trying to launch to the wrong set of people. Everything is worth discussing with your team and sort of taking to them and solve together. Like, that's one thing I've learned. And they show up. Like, the more you ask for help, the more you see people coming and showing up and participating.
So that's all, some of exactly what I was gonna say, but one thing I'm gonna add on is that I would say one of the most important qualities to, like, instill in yourself and get comfortable with is actually courage. You know, people think that research and UX even generally is a lot of, like, heads down, actually, like, doing the research, doing design work. But the reality is, particularly the more senior you get, the more time you're spending actually proving impact or having to deal with politics, defend yourself. And depending on the organization, particularly if you're either one researcher by yourself or in a small organization, you are the only one who is going to stand up for the user. You are the only one who's going to be the dissenting voice in the room that says, actually, we're going into the wrong market. So in some ways, it's your responsibility to do that as a researcher. You're probably the only one who has, like, training in ethics and how to, like, treat people. So you have to be willing to stand up for yourself, your people, and be brave in the face of, you know, a lot of other people who might not agree with you. So, and this is particularly challenging for some of the reasons that were already brought up, but we tend to be very, like, empathetic, compassionate, thoughtful, people-pleasing kind of people, which means, like, being courageous and standing up and arguing with people is a little scary until you get used to it. So essentially, like, putting yourself into as many uncomfortable situations as early as possible will really help your career.
Right. The fact that many all three of you have touched on something around courage, or that you're standing up for so many people. That can be a lot of pressure. Have any of you ever experienced imposter syndrome? And if so, how did you deal with it?
I was just going to say, like, all the time. And for me, the flavor of it that I sort of experience is actually not coming from academia and not being a researcher. Like earlier on, I would just be like, oh, do I know this methodology? And you know, like, even when I've gained experience and I feel comfortable, you know, executing work, sometimes I still feel like, just, you know, I feel more of a tech person than an academician. And I just, you know, the way I deal with it is I keep trying to learn and sort of also at some point be like, you know, you're crazy, you've got this, sort of just be my own champion. And I'm still working through it, but that's my flavor of imposter syndrome. And then, and the funny thing is I feel like, and this is where it gets you, right? The things that actually work for me, that is my tech background or me having been an engineer, it really helps facilitate like conversations with people who are very tech, and you know, it helps me more than hinders me. But yeah, weirdly, if I let it, it gets to me as like, maybe I'm not as strong as a researcher. So I have to keep reminding myself that that's not true and I've got this.
Yeah, I think imposter syndrome probably is something that happens to all of us at various moments in time. In fact, honestly, I would say almost all of my clients actually deal with this on a daily basis. But a way to reframe it, to think about it, is often when you're feeling imposter syndrome, you're doing something that's a little uncomfortable and new to you. So essentially, when you're feeling that, it's almost good to just like lean in and be like, oh, wait, I know that I'm terrified, but that means I'm actually trying to grow. So you can reframe it as a positive thing, as long as you're not like beating yourself up. But like recently I started teaching a graduate class at Berkeley for the first time. And you, like, I was panicked the entire week before, because I'm like, I don't know how to do research. Wait, I've been doing it like a decade, so I probably do know what I'm doing, huh? They wouldn't be letting me teach a bunch of people if I didn't, but it happens to all of us.
Yeah, like definitely plus one. Anybody who's telling you they have never felt imposter syndrome is either a sociopath or a liar. It's everyone. Like, I've talked to CEOs and nobody's ever been like, every single day I come in and I just crush it. And yeah, it's uncomfortable. And I think the opportunity, especially as a researcher, is always to research that feeling, like lean into it and say, hey, what's going on? Like, what about this is making me feel uncomfortable? And start to talk to your team. Like, your team is there to support you and the research. So don't be shy about saying like, hey, this thing is coming up, I'm feeling really overwhelmed, here's my plan, can I run it by you? Or I'm thinking about these ways. Or even like, yesterday's meeting was super uncomfortable, I felt like people thought I sucked, can I talk to you about that? Like, can I walk through it? And don't sit on those feelings, because often, most of the time, they're gonna be like, I have no idea what you're talking about, you did great. But there's something to be said there, right? Like, what is originating it? How could you address it? And what can you do? Though I will say, I also think like Michelle Obama had one of my favorite quotes on this, which is, I'm gonna butcher it completely, but that she became a lot less worried about how smart everybody else in the room was when she realized how dumb everybody was. So like, lean in, like, just try it, be loud. Like, maybe they call you on something that you say wrong, but like, so what? You're a researcher, you go, oh, that's fascinating, I'm so glad I learned something new, and just move on. Don't fixate on it too much.
Those are all really great pieces of advice. I wanna switch gears a little bit here and talk about skills that a researcher needs. So I know that we talk about the methods that we use, like observation and interviewing, but what research skills do you recommend developing kind of outside learning about the methods?
So I'm going to pop in here with an unpopular opinion. So I look at probably 5 to 6 people's resumes each week to give feedback. And if you want me to look at yours, send it to me on LinkedIn. I'm happy to send you feedback. We have this tendency to be like, I can do all these methods, it's so cool. Which to me is the most worthless data in the world, right? Oh, did I freeze?
No, you're good.
Okay, sorry, I'm frozen on my end. Like, somebody comes up to you on the street and says, I am the best hammerer in the world, I've hammered 1,000 times, let me build you a birdhouse. And you're like, cool, birdhouses have nails, this is great. And they come back to you with this thing that is cut wrong, it's unlevel, it doesn't even have a hook to hang. But they technically had the method, like the hammering is perfect. well, that's actually totally useless to you. And even to that end, they might say, I've hammered 1,000 things. Let me hammer together just those 2 pieces of wood for you. And it's messed up because just because you've done it 1,000 times doesn't mean you did it right ever. So like throw those skills on your resume and say, yes, I can hammer. Yes, I can make sure things are level, whatever those pieces are. But what I want to know is what your impact is. How did you make sure that people used that data? How did you make sure that you were thinking of the right users and protecting those users? Who did you stand up to? What did you make happen? What did you make not happen? Like what launches did you block and say, these are not happening. They're terrible for the user. And those are the pieces that I'd encourage you to really lean into skill-wise. Have uncomfortable conversations with people who disagree with you politically. Do those things that are just weird, really not fun, and that's what's going to help you in your research, because that's how you're going to make a good argument. That's how you're actually going to make sure the research is impactful, rather than like, I published this really pretty paper that 3 people read, right? That's a waste of your time.
I totally agree. I've hired people for my team before, and I don't care what methods they do or do not know. I care if they understand why they are doing what they're doing. So understanding how you choose to sign up, design a research project, and also can you like solve problems and learn new things and be curious. If I'm talking like practical skills, honestly, it has nothing to do with research methods. Is can you have an engaging conversation with another human being and get them to give you interesting, useful information? Can you do that without like a lot of preparation and a lot of, you know, stuff in front of you to like do it? Because the best conversations as a researcher are ones where you don't have a script, where you go in completely off the rails. My favorite interview I have ever done was when a participant refused to continue with the test we were doing, and we had a conversation about healthcare, completely unscripted. It was probably one of the best I had ever done to date, and even now. So essentially think about how are you good at like relating to human beings, to understanding them, to like looking for patterns, but that's not a particular method. That's really just having skills in understanding humans.
Yeah, completely. I think y'all both covered like most of the things that even I wanted to say. I'll just add like one more thing is sort of related to what both of you said is in our day-to-day where I think like the percentage keeps reducing the more time I spend in research of like how much time I spend doing the research versus how much time I have to like, you know, spend in meetings and sort of presenting the work both formally or just like sort of scheming, you know, that 1 minute. I mean, not anymore, but there've been times where I've just like timed my coffee break to a time where I know like the head PM is there, but I need to hustle and sort of say like, hey, that thing, that project that we're all working towards, I don't know if it's like, you know, it's headed in the right direction and you have to have that conversation and you have 5 minutes. So it's really about like, you know, communicating your work in so many different forms, both formal and informal. Another skill that I'm trying to get better at even now is like, we do a lot of work and then we, you know, we create these presentations, and even in interviews, a lot of us get tested on our presentation skills, whether it's a deck. But in reality, it's like, you know, having soft influence outside of those decks, right? Like what Megan said, like how can you have conversations with human beings without them feeling like you're just, you know, basically having influence without authority. I have been meaning to read that book, but yeah, that's essentially like the skill that we keep having to use day in and day out. And the second thing I wanted to add is just having a really thick skin, because you're gonna not get invited to meetings. You're gonna see like, you know, strategy come off of your work, representing your work in the wrong light, or just, you know, sort of misinterpretation of research. And so you just have to be, not take things personally and find this energy to come back day in and day out and just keep doing it. So I think, yeah, whatever it takes to build those skills, that's what comes handy day, you know, in day to day, even more than research methodologies.
Yeah. And just be flexible, like do yoga every day for 2 weeks, just to see what that feels like. You are going to have research sessions that don't go right. And to speak to what Meg said, one of my best was one that came in for a product test. He literally was like the angriest person I've ever met, was so out of it, clearly was having a bad day. And I was like, oh man, I need coffee. And I just took this participant to Starbucks. And we talked about a completely different project for an hour and got some foundational insights that I wasn't going to start for 2 weeks, but it gave me a diving board because that's what I had in the moment. Like, assume that the world is not out to get you. Invite yourself to those meetings. Just put yourself out there and expect that it is not going to go right, probably at least 30% of the time, and that's totally okay. If the research fails, like your whole project blows up, you get nothing out of it, move on. So what? Just be flexible with it.
Yeah.
That is a quotable moment right there. If your whole research project fails, so what? Move on. But yeah, I mean, really great advice. There's nothing that you can do about some things, especially when we are dealing with other humans and we can't control everything. So, especially human behavior. I wanted to ask, you mentioned soft skills, Sam, and I was just curious, what soft skills have you found to be most valuable in the workplace and why?
Yeah, I think building off of what I said, and I'm still working on some of these myself too. So it's not like I'm an expert in these just yet. But one thing is definitely like having influence. And it sounds really simple, but it's kind of like, you know, through these like one-on-ones, through meeting 5-minute meetings, like one of the things with, you know, tech and probably big tech companies is you have like 20 minutes or 30 minutes with a person like every two to three weeks. And you're expected to like change their whole perspective on a project that they've poured their life into, right? Like, so how do you do that? And it doesn't come from being a researcher. It doesn't come from having expertise. It's you really have to build those relationships with people. So that they trust you and come to you for, or take your opinion on things. So that's one. And another one I think I've been working on more and more is just being able to market your work. I feel like, again, maybe this is not as popular an opinion, but I feel UX researchers are not this, like nothing in our skill set trains us for the amount of marketing of our work that we end up having to do. So I actually like, market researchers at Facebook, at least, like I've met a few that are brilliant at doing this, and, you know, other disciplines, sometimes people are great at doing this and I just learn from them. But like, you really have to be able to have like the 30-second pitch of your work. You know, if you had only a minute, how do you summarize the most crucial findings, all of that. Yeah, those are the two things I feel I'm working on and I feel are super valuable, and that's what helps researchers grow.
I want to add on to your first point, because I think influence is probably maybe the most important skill as a researcher, because no one cares about research if you can't do anything with it, at least in industry. So the thing I want to add is that you often hear about like networking as like a crucial soft skill, but I don't like thinking of it as networking because it makes it very transactional. Like, it's very much like, what can you give me and what can I give you? Whereas like genuine curiosity about other people and what makes them tick, and even your coworkers, like what can you do to help them? Why are they having a bad day? What can you do to like make them, you know, likely to be on your side? Which is all about like building relationships, influence, curiosity, and really thinking about, you know, other human beings out there and how you can build genuine relationships with them over the long term. Like, we can sniff out, everyone can, when someone is trying to like use you for a particular thing. The kind of networking that is really beneficial to everyone is when you just actually really are surrounded by a bunch of people you like and respect. And then you can, you know, occasionally recommend each other for jobs and stuff. But networking with the purpose of getting a job, much less effective.
Yeah, I definitely want to, we're just going to keep plus one-ing each other. It's great. I think there's a couple things here that touch on this, but one is just assume best intentions. People are going to piss you off. They're going to really be annoying. Keep trying to reframe it like a research project and say like, okay, well, if they were doing this for the consumer or if they were doing this for the business, why might they be doing this? And really just as much as you can, try to guess at what they were getting at. I love that your background just changed. It feels like a night shift. Try to get at that and really just understand like, is there another version of this that I could see? And then I do want to say like, I totally agree with what Meg's saying about networking, but also ask for what you need. Be really transparent with your team, with your colleagues, with people you don't know. Like, gosh, I get so many LinkedIn requests that have nothing on them. They're just like, maybe. I reject every single one of them. But if you write to me and say, hey, I heard that you're good at reviewing resumes, or I see that you work at Lyft and I want to hear about that, be upfront and I am here to help you. And the same is with your teammates, right? If you're really not getting something they're doing, or you don't understand a business goal, or you don't understand why a decision was made, say like, hey, I really didn't like the way this went. Something went up. Like, own those moments and just make sure people are giving you what you need and you're not sitting there drowning. Like, why is nobody listening to me? Why is this not happening the way I think it should be?
Yes, I do want to say that I've just transported myself to the one of our labs here in the studio. No, it was a total night mode thing. I realized I didn't have the lights on. So my next question is actually about the sometimes controversial qual versus quant. So how do you choose between a qualitative and quantitative? Or is it just, are we at a place where it's mixed methods? You need to, you know, you should know both. Like, what do you guys think?
So I think it depends on the size of the company. I will say, I get this question a lot and people are like, I don't know how to use R. Could I ever get a job? Yes, definitely. There are data scientists for that. Like at the major company, there are qual and quant researchers. They are separate. If that is something that is really not interesting to you, don't spend your time going down that path. I happen to be a mixed methods researcher just because I came from a completely different field. But I will tell you, like, I have papers published on really complex statistical analyses. I have never done those in tech. I tried to once and my manager was like, this is cool. I don't know what it means. Give me, like, are they different? That's all I want to know. Which one should I pick? So they really can work together, but they're simple. If you're really into quant, go into it. If you're not, don't worry about it. I tend to summarize the difference between qual and quant as quant tells you what and qual tells you why. Quant is really broad and gives you a big direction of your group. Qual gives you a really detailed section of potentially a very biased sample, right? YouTube, for example, on TV did not work for the blind until last year. They forgot to test it with blind people. So make sure you have the right sample if you're going to rely on entirely on qual. Mixed methods makes sure basically that you're picking up all those pieces, but rely on your teammates. There's probably somebody who's there that's really good at quant. And if you are somebody who like totally isn't, reach out to an engineer, help them involve in the research process. Everyone here in your company is there to support you. It's both, but don't feel like you have to do both if you don't want to.
Totally agree with that. And I'm saying that from the perspective of someone who's also been like the only researcher like at a growing startup, which means, you know, if I don't know how to do it, probably someone either doesn't know how to do it, period, or we're going to have to like collaborate on something. I'm mixed methods as well. But one thing to keep in mind with mixing methods is you can also mix multiple qual methods, multiple quant methods, mix them all together. There's this really famous paper from, I think, 1979 about triangulation that you guys should read. If you all should read, if you're interested in the more academic version of that. But particularly working with like startups or people who have products that like they haven't found product market fit yet, or they don't know who their users are, you pretty much can't do quant research. So if you're someone who wants to work at like early stage companies, highly recommend focusing more on qual, because the reality is you probably don't have any data, even if you want it. So I will tell you from experience, companies that you think have a lot of data don't, including really big ones. So if I were to pick, particularly if you're in that area of interest, I would focus on qual.
Yeah, like Zoe said, we're just gonna keep plus one each other. And I think just wanted to add to that, like, definitely, if you're looking from a job finding perspective, you know, don't try to be qual or try to be quant just because you think that's going to, you know, up your chances of getting hired. Like, there's lots of companies that have like completely different tracks. Both the places I've worked at, you know, they are different jobs, essentially. One thing I'll add is, you know, it helps to know just enough about another discipline to help you sort of know if you need, if the questions you're trying to answer are best answered by, you know, through a quantitative method or through a qualitative, right? I say that, like, I'm very qualitative, and now more and more I'm trying to, especially with Facebook, with, you know, a place where there is a lot of data, I'm trying to like triangulate data more and more. So just balancing, mixing my qual insights with backing it up with quant data as well. And so I'm finding it very useful to sort of understand what methodologies my quant partners want to use. What do they mean? I don't need to know to execute it. But there's this, you know, there's a saying of like, you kind of have to know something about a field enough to at least comment on it or use it at a high level. And so that's what I would recommend. Just like read up, because qual and quant, I think you, even if they're separate tracks, you end up having to collaborate. So just know enough about the field to do that. Like there's, even though I don't write surveys myself, I'm always reading up on Medium or just, you know, like articles lots of people are writing these days, just to keep myself informed. And that's always useful.
And just to tie it back, like, say no. If you know enough about a survey, as Sam pointed out, like you can know when you're supposed to use a survey and when you're not. And if your team comes to you and you says, I know you're an entirely qual researcher, but I really want to know if we should launch a credit card, it's not a qual project. And you just say no, right? Like maybe you can suggest something else, but you also can hire a firm to do that research for you, bring other people in, hire a contractor for 3 months to run that for you. There's other solutions. And you as a researcher, yes, your job is the research, but it's also just to make sure the right research is being done. And if it's not you, don't do it. Don't give them bad data. Don't send them down the wrong path because you're really afraid your PM's going to be mean. They're going to be mean anyway, so give them the good stuff.
And to add a little bit onto this, also don't let them dictate to you what method to use. You are the expert in the room, which means if someone says we need to do a survey and you realize, wait, a survey is not going to give us what we want, you have to push back and be the one to be like, actually, we need to do this.
And I think that's actually a very, very common one as a qual. I don't know what the quant UXR version of this is, but as a qual UXR, I often have like this request of like, why are you only talking to 8 people? How is this actually like valuable? You know, let's just do a survey. You have, you know, I think one way to manage that is to keep digging at the person. You don't have to push back if you don't feel comfortable. You can just ask them like, why do you feel more comfortable with a survey? Just ask them enough questions. I've often found that like, if you ask like 5 follow-up questions, they're like, okay, maybe I don't know why I need a survey, you know? So just kind of like work with why they're asking for that. And then, yeah, like if it still seems like a really strong need, just say no, like Zoe said.
Just to cut Brittany off again, sorry, Brittany. Like, you're like, sometimes they ask for things just because it's the only thing they know, right? They know they needed to write something down. So they're like, Meg, make me a survey, do an interview. And you're like, this doesn't make sense. Pushing back in those instances isn't even actually pushing back, because you'll be like, hey, actually, I think a card sort makes more sense. And they'll be like, didn't know a card sort was the same. Thanks. So for them, like, I have seen so many people spin early career and they're like, he keeps telling me to do these things and it just doesn't make sense. And you get all worked up and it's literally, they just don't know any other methods.
What's the NPS? Don't even get me started on that. That's a whole like panel itself.
Or let's just run an A/B test. That's another one I hear, you know? which there are several things we don't need to do right now. But Sam, you touched on learning. And so I wanted to get a question in there for people who might be transitioning into UXR, you know, from another field, maybe don't have the time or the money to go to a traditional higher education. Where's a good place to start with breaking into UX research and improve skills outside of the more formal university?
So one thing I would recommend is really like mining your existing background for transferable skills. As all of us have shown tonight, the top things you need as a UX researcher are not like these very specific UX research methods or knowledge. It's really about all of these other skills that make you an excellent, impactful researcher. So almost any career has at least a subset, if not almost all of those skills. So like, you know, a nurse could be a great UX researcher because they have to deal with people and have really challenging conversations. So look at your existing background and essentially market yourself using that. Put it into UX terms. A lot of it's just jargon. So just translate it. And then the other thing is really just start living your life like a UX researcher. You can actually look at your own life and all of the people around you and learn all of these skills just by essentially UXing your life, which is a ridiculous concept, but it can be life-changing if you start really having that lens on everything you do.
Yeah, definitely on this like marketing past skills, a couple notes on that. One, it might be even broader. Photographers make great UX researchers because they think about what do I want to see in my subject and what does my subject want to see in this film? That's a very empathetic UX research skill. So think about everything that you're doing in that space. Also your resume, does not just need to be a reflection of your main job duties, right? If you used to be a makeup artist, that's actually another huge one, right? You're figuring out like, what are people's allergens? What works well for their skin tone? What works for things? Highlight those pieces. You don't need to say like, I sold a bunch of stuff. Focus on the stuff that's actually gonna transfer to UX, because what the first person who's gonna read it is a recruiter, and they're gonna spend less than 3 minutes on your resume. Sorry, it's just true, make them short. But if you can say and like briefly, oh yeah, these are all things, and they go, oh great, check, 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 they've got these. You're in front of the researcher, right? You've gotten through actually the hardest part, and now you're in front of a human and you can actually have that conversation and say, this is why I'm actually a great UX researcher, despite the fact that I don't have this on my resume yet. And I'll say the other thing is to do projects, as Meg pointed out, but also reach out to nonprofits. If there is a local nonprofit in your town, I guarantee you they have never had the money to do UX research. If you are a designer, reach out even more, because you can fix things pretty quickly for them too, or at least point out like, this is why the payments aren't working. Or if we deleted this one screen on your donation button, your donations would probably increase because people don't realize there's an end screen. Reach out to those people, just do it and say, I just wanted to do this thing. It would be really great if you could tell me if this was impactful, right? Did you make a change from this that then I can pitch to somebody else and say that I did these things? But there are a million nonprofits out there. Find one that really matters to you, that jives with you, because you might end up in a really long relationship with them. I've been working with the same one for 2 years, and every single meeting I get just so hyped. They're amazing to work with. So
yeah. I just want to add one like caveat to that. Nonprofits are amazing to work with and you should work with them, but be very careful about giving your work away for free to non-nonprofits. There's this tendency to do that. And one, it sort of devalues your own work in your own brain, which means like once you get to the point where you're interviewing and stuff, it's going to be a lot harder for you to project this air of like, I know my shit. Also, it devalues UX research as a whole, because it's saying essentially this valuable thing is worth giving away. There are very few other disciplines that give away free labor, period.
And even like we know, if you charge $5 for things, people are going to show up in way higher rates. Charging for it does inherently increase its value. So yeah, nonprofits you love, not for profits.
Yeah, I think that about summarizes what I would have said too. Like, get your some amount of formal learning. Just like I even today, like if I want to try a different methodology, I go on the internet and just crunch for all like easy to consume articles on like how, you know, there's so many people that write in our community. That's the wonderful thing about it. Like I go and read and sort of learn up on that method. I don't just stick to the knowledge available within the company. Whatever format you get that, like, you know, education, go and practice it. That's, yeah, that would be my plus one too. Just find projects and really it's a muscle. The more you do it, you know, the more confident you get. Like when I, back in grad school, there was a period of time where I couldn't find a job. And I think that moment where you're finished studying and you're trying in on the hunt for a job, it can really like bring down your confidence. And you know, there were periods where I'm like, do I even know what I'm doing? Because you go to these interviews and they give you rejections and you kind of sort of associate that with your worth. So just doing work, having something, a project or a hackathon even, that's a nice way to get not to free work, but also get something cool on your resume. It's a shorter time commitment. I've done hackathons and where, you know, there's mixed disciplines participating. But I get a project out of it. I get a huge confidence boost because I'm like, I know I got it. And then you still get your project done. So yeah.
Great. Speaking of education, we actually have a question in the audience. Sarah, she wants to know, are master's degrees necessary? Nope.
No. Go ahead, Zoe.
It's just not. Like, you're going to get these skills a million different ways. I have a master's in wildlife sciences. Like, nobody's looking at that and being like, that's going to be great for UX, until you like walk them through how it might be. If you have one, awesome. Like, it will make it a little bit easier, just because basically it makes that conversation easier, right? Like, you're like, this is the impact. The impact is that I got a master's, right? Nobody's writing, I went to school and studied these like 9 methods. They're just saying I have the impact. But that impact can come from so many different things. It can come from volunteering. It can come from a boot camp if you want it to. It can come from just starting these things, just reading a million articles, as Sam has pointed out. Just focus on that impact. If you're not into a master's, if you just don't want to go back to school, if you don't want to spend the money, I really don't think it's necessary.
Yeah, totally agree, as a fellow master's haver. I loved grad school, and I also got grad school funded, so it was a particularly easy decision for me to do. But like, the reason I went to grad school wasn't necessarily to like get a job. The reason I went to grad school is I kind of love school, and I love doing research, and I, you know, these are things that you get the opportunity to do in a very contained environment and in grad school that you can't do otherwise. So if those things like excite you, of course get a master's, but don't get it as like a job qualification, because Zoe said you can get it anywhere else. You can get these skills anywhere else.
Yeah, and I think our field now has more and more, you know, started shifting towards like not looking for just like formal degrees. So I would heavily plus one that. The only thing I'll add is like, it also is very personal, right? Like I am a person, you know, if you just give me, if I just were to take a 1 year sabbatical to go and learn something without any structure, I'm going to get nothing done in that 1 year. I cannot trust myself to be that disciplined. So it helps me when I put myself through a curriculum, you know, people who I know are going to sort of hold me accountable. That accountability is a factor for me to learn something new. For me personally, a degree or some sort of a formal education would help. But if you're not like that, if you've always done better when you go challenge yourself to do something and you get those things done, I think that's, yeah, you can just skip. And go, and especially if it's not an option for you right now and you're going to struggle through it, just skip that and get the education some other way.
We got a lot of people asking a variation of the question, like, where should I be looking for these additional resources? Do you have any like reliable websites or boot camps, or, you know, how do I get and stay informed and educate myself?
Nielsen Norman Group is my personal favorite. It's very research driven. They know their shit and have known their shit for the last 30 years. So big fan there.
Meg, you're referring to the website where they have like a lot of the information hosted? Yeah. Because their certification courses are, you know, you have to pay for them.
Yeah, I mean, their website though has tons of stuff on it that's free. Yeah. It's also a great one if you're just like, I want to know what a card sort is, read it and then go do one. Yeah. Medium has some great articles. Read a couple because they will disagree with each other. There are so many great mentor resources. That's really what I encourage you to look into. I personally work with UX Coffee Hours, but there's also, I think, design.org. There's a bunch now. Sign up for a ton of them and come back. Like if your mentor says to you, hey, set up another slot, like I'll put more time on my calendar, take advantage of it. They have something to share and they'll give you what you need and help you address those things. Yeah. Don't worry about textbooks. They're very expensive and not worth it.
Yeah. Just a plug. I know this is, some of my past colleagues at Google, I know have recently launched, Zoe or Meg, if you have more details on this, I'm blanking and I can follow up, but they launched a bootcamp course, I believe, through the Google platform for, UX specifically. I don't know that it's specific to UX research, but I know they have one for UX in general. Yeah, Meg, do you?
Yeah, it's definitely a UX, I believe it's UX design focus. I haven't like gone in depth in the curriculum, but I mean, another thing to consider is like a lot of these online courses, even if you don't do the full course, like a lot of the resources that they link to are in fact available online. So if you can get access to those, that's actually a really good one because they summarize it in one place for you.
Yeah. And I think Yale even has a bunch of them too. Like remember the UX courses may be helpful, but also other things like empathy building and in collaboration are also really helpful courses to lean into. It doesn't have to be traditional UX.
Yeah, I think like storytelling and marketing courses would be like amazing.
Those are good suggestions. There's
just one more that I want to add, like to the flavor of like not just UX is like there's this site on design sprints. Like if you just Google it, you should be able to find it. It's an amazing site full of resources. So again, like if you don't have too much training and you find yourself organizing workshops or things, or you know, for your team that you're working on, I found that to be super helpful. It's kind of just like all planned and resources exist on the site.
Cool. And I was just going to suggest if anybody else has resources that they want to share with the group, feel free to drop them in the chat. You can share with each other. Okay, so one question from Jordan is he's wondering what computer programs he or she should learn to be competitive in the field. Is there anything like prototyping wise or for data collection that you guys are seeing?
I mean, Qualtrics, if you're going to write a survey, they're still kind of the standard. If you're going to do quant, R, because no matter how big or small your company is, they can afford it because it's free. But honestly, no, I feel like it's actually one of the reasons I struggle with some of the boot camps is they come out and they really train you to use like one design program. Like you are amazing at Figma, and like, sorry, spoiler alert, Figma's going to go away in 3 to 4 years and be replaced by the next Figma, because that has happened 5 times already and it's just going to continue to happen. So learn to be interested enough that you want to learn these new things. But if you specifically need a card sorting thing, just Google it and see the one that you like the user interface of. Like, you're a researcher, you know how to judge a good site.
That's my answer. I know how to use Qualtrics, never used it professionally. I know how to use R, never used it professionally. So like, it doesn't matter. Like, be creative, know how to learn things and go find the answer.
Yeah, it's also like very dependent on the company. Like if it's a smaller company, maybe you're going and setting things up there. Like, you know, at Google and Facebook, I feel like there are these micro trends that don't exist really outside of the company, but I'll just share in case someone's really looking for something. Like I know I've heard MaxDiff thrown around a lot, like MaxDiff surveys is the quant methodology in the last year or so. Maybe it's my Facebook Google bubble, but that's one that's come up. I forgot about the second one. I'll say it if it comes back to me.
Yeah, and you can do a MaxDiff in a whole bunch of different programs. Conjoints are a slightly more complicated version of those. If you're not going to be quanti, I wouldn't lean into that because they're really easy to misinterpret, which can also be very negative. But this is kind of like what I made earlier. Like, again, because you can use a hammer doesn't mean you can build. Because you can use R doesn't mean you can run a good survey. So yes, learn them, but focus on impact. Show me that you're a good researcher. Don't tell me that you can hammer.
I will agree with that. I know I'm not one of the panelists here, but I think that the education, the methods, the process is more important than the tools. This is a question that I think our panelists might hate me for, but I'm gonna do it anyway. So we have the highest question people wanna hear about is advice on research purposes. So should
you knew that was going to be the question the moment you said we were going to hate it.
We'll hate it. Like,
hate it.
We need a UX research portfolio. Should I have one? Should I not have one? And so, like, any advice?
Oh man. Okay. I'm going to start because this is like a personal crusade of mine. Like, probably just 5-6 years ago, I wrote a post on Medium about why I refuse to have a portfolio and never will. And I've stuck to it, and I've gotten plenty of job offers and interviews, including from all the big companies. So don't think that you absolutely need one. However, you do need to have projects that you can speak to and speak to in depth. And I think one of the things that benefited me is that I also did have a body of writing that I could point to. So when someone had a portfolio link, I would link them to my piece about why I didn't have a portfolio. But why I don't have a portfolio is I think it almost always, and I've never seen an example where this isn't true, oversimplifies the process. I think having a conversation with someone about a project is just as easy and much better than a portfolio. And there's all this research about how aesthetics deeply affects how we interpret something and put value on it, which means, yeah, the prettier things are going to get higher up in the stack ranking. That's just psychological truth. So it's going to focus on the wrong thing. So I could rant about this for an hour, but I'm interested to hear what other people say.
Actually, I totally agree. I had one. I don't think anybody looked at it. My partner is now a pretty high up designer at Facebook. And he was like, I think we still need it because I'm a designer. And I swear he spent like 6 weeks on this thing, and he put a password protection on it so he could see how many times they looked at it and really track it, and nobody looked at it. And they made him an amazing offer. Like, and he ruined so many weekends. I cannot even tell you how much I would have liked to have those weekends back. So I do think there's randomly jobs that really require it. What I hear in mentorship sessions, for some reason, that they're more common in Europe. I don't require them when I consider people. It's not part of the Lyft application process. Even as a junior, as a newbie, again, focus on that impact. Like, it's a way to show that you can do a method, but I don't know what it did. So I'd rather have the opportunity to talk to you about it. One thing I will say though, huge caveat is if anybody's unfamiliar with how the hiring process works at major tech companies, is you're going to go through a recruiter screen. You're then going to go through a researcher screen. Either Facebook likes to do like a mock research scenario, other people just like to have a conversation. And then you're going to have an on-site where you present a presentation of your work. Yeah. Spend your time there, because that's the thing that's actually going to sell you. You've got six people in the room. You can answer questions live. You can highlight things like emotional drama. You don't have to type everything. Mine is very visual. There's actually very little text on any of my slides in those presentations. And beyond that, like, by the way, once you're in at these companies, it's really hard to talk about what you do. I have projects that I have spent over a year of my life at that I cannot even tell you what they were about until 2 years from now, right? That's gonna happen. So I really don't think you should spend your time there, even as a newbie. If you're really desperate to, I don't know, like link to the thing that it did. If it's an app, show them the app, but just focus on that that presentation. But I'm, you know, maybe Sam's totally gonna disagree with us, so.
No, I think I totally agree. I feel like if we, you know, if anyone's done analysis, like you said, your boyfriend had like some method to track it. I feel like the people that look at portfolios most often are other people looking for jobs who are trying to build their portfolio. It's like, I don't know how many times a recruiter or an actual person looking to hire looks through those things. I had like a domain name and everything, and I just don't maintain it anymore because I don't see the point. Like LinkedIn is so great. You can just keep that, make that a good portfolio, and you know, that's a job well done. I think it's important to have a resume. It's like and a resume that reads well and sort of like positions the work that you've done in a good way. And like, you know, I think that's sort of more key. If you had only time to get one thing done, do that. But I'll just add, like, what happens is what, you know, you go, you listen to this advice, but you go and you see people in your cohort are making portfolios, and there's this FOMO of like, do I need to have one? So if you find yourself in that place and you really are planning to do it, just, yeah, like the thing that's most important is having one project that you can speak really well to, because that is what you get interviewed on, right? So maybe focus, if you do want to have a portfolio, do it around that one project. Yeah, like just like, you know, they were saying, don't spend so many weekends and time on it. Like have a time frame. Just say you're going to get your portfolio done in like a week and get it done. And that's it. Like stop improving upon it. No one's looking at it. It is a conversation piece. And the focus should really be on you in the room or virtually these days, you know, speaking through that process and communicating what it is that you got done.
Yeah, honestly, I would spend more time, buy yourself one of those cute little field notes, notebooks. It's about this big. And jot the keynotes of it so that when they ask you something, you can say just 1 second and flip your little notebook open and talk about the three things that you know you want to hear about because you're stressed in the interview. That is such a better use of your time. And even if they say like, I really want a portfolio, I've literally been like, here's a deck that's public. Have at it, because it's just as helpful.
Yeah. Just be creative. I mean, you're a UX person. So why are people asking you for a portfolio? They want some sort of evidence that you know what you're doing and you can talk about a process. Give them something that meets those criteria.
Yeah, so it sounds like those presentation skills, which were touched on earlier too, with like socializing your insights, right? We need to be able to do that, or knowing how to market your work. That makes a lot of sense. So great, glad we got that out of the way. We're at time, and I think the remaining 20 minutes are for breakout to do some networking live. I do want to ask you though, I want to leave you with one last question, and that is, we talked a lot about influence tonight, and that was one of the skills that you said was most important, was knowing how to influence people. And we have a question from Eamon that's asking, what is the best way to extract UX research findings and insights? And in particular, how do you turn them into decisions that might influence designs later on? So the first part of that might be a little bit difficult, right? But the second part, like, how do you get that influence? How do you make something actionable?
I'll start with this one. This is a personal topic of mine I'm very passionate about. The reality is, once you've done all your work, it's a lot harder to extract that information if you didn't start with it. So one of the things I highly recommend everyone does is tie all of your work to some sort of either metric or outcome that you know your organization or business cares about. Like, if you know one of your goals is like increase subscriptions by X percent, how is this research going to help that? Then you can organize your findings around like, this thing is lowering, you know, our subscriptions. This is increasing our subscriptions. As it turns out, no one knows what our product is, so we don't have any subscriptions. You know, essentially everything can then tie to the central theme. Doesn't mean you can't also like give lots of other really relevant information in findings, which is inevitable with good research, but having that key thing that is like the thread throughout all of your research that you can go, all right, so we set out wanting to understand how to increase subscriptions. Let me tell you the five ways we can focus on increasing subscriptions based on all of this research we did. Then you have impact with your business stakeholders, people outside your organization, and it helps you organize your research a lot. So that's my take.
Yeah, huge plus one to that. Like, you know, if you, a lot of times like products have like their yearly or, you know, goals for the half, rooting around that just like gets like senior leadership to pay attention and then everyone else follows suit as well. Another thing I'll add is like, you know, people will quote your research if it's easy to quote. So again, if it's like a bunch of insights that are buried on different slides in a deck, that's hard for people to sort of talk about. So just having like the TLDR version of your work, and again, it's a challenge in the current times, but like in physical spaces, like I think the most impactful work that I've done is, you know, it's nothing different than all the other projects I did, but I also made a poster of the work and just hung it in different places. I turned it into really visual artifacts. And you know, this was a persona project. And so there was like really visual artifacts that came out of it that we could use in other places in marketing materials. And it just became like the word of mouth publicity on that kind of thing. It travels really quickly. So yeah, I think just making it easy for people to recreate your insights, repeat your insights without you in the room, like what are different ways you could do that? That really like amplifies the impact and makes it very actionable.
Yeah, totally. I think the other piece of it is like, get your team really involved from the start, right? One, you're going to have to say no if it doesn't tie to an OKR, sorry, an organizational key metric. As Meg pointed out, don't do it. Like I map out my quarters based on requests and do prioritizations twice a year. And there is always like 70 weeks worth of research requested every 30 weeks. There's no way you could do it all. But once you've said, yes, this is the thing we're focusing on, say, here's my study plan. I want feedback. I need feedback by this date and harass people. Here's the script. Like, I think there's this tendency to like, oh, I want to own it. I don't want anybody else to tell me I'm wrong. They're not telling you you're wrong. They're saying I need this other thing out of it, or I'm not seeing it. There's something we're not understanding. So really encourage that to make sure the research is answering the questions that your team needs it to answer, that you're actually all on the same page, right? We're both looking at the same sky and saying, yes, that is the moon, and no, that's not a star, whatever that might be. And yeah, follow through, like check in on things, hold them to it. If the research is not being used or something else is different, fight for the user, really push on those pieces of it.
Yeah, it's like the IKEA effect, right? Like if you get them to sort of like put their sort of time and energy into thinking about it, then they're going to be so much more tied to the outcome.
Yeah, thanks so much for sharing everything that you guys have shared tonight. I think that I've already been following the chat and there's a lot of really great comments that we're getting. So thank you so much. I'm gonna hand it back to James so that he can initiate the networking.
Thank you so much to all of our panelists. And let's give a thank you to our fantastic moderator, Brittany, as well. Virtual round of applause. With that said, we appreciate our partners, Denver UX Newbies, Betty and the Tile team for providing us with this lovely webinar to keep track of everyone's amazing questions. And of course, to each and every one of you who chose to spend your evening with us, we sincerely appreciate it.